do want to ask you about one name, Sam, that I've heard more and more as we get closer to the draft. That's Marco Kasper.
Yep.
And that's not a name that 6 weeks ago, 8 weeks ago, I saw kind of cracking into the top 10, but I do see him now in some people's top 10. Like, what can you tell us and our listeners about Kasper? Because he seems like he might be one of the more interesting names here in the draft.
He will be a top 10 guy, and he will be a guy that, for, I think, the general public, will shake things up a little bit inside that top 10. I think he comes into the conversation as early as 5, and it may be earlier than that. But I can't see him either getting past Ottawa, and for sure Ottawa, he's not getting past Detroit. So that puts him in the top 8 position. What's happened with this young man is he started the year in Rögle. It's the Abbott brothers that run the Rögle program as general manager and head coach. So those guys have had experience playing in North America. They made their mark as players, coaches, general managers in Denmark and in Sweden. So they are very familiar and still very connected with what happens in North America and the NHL game. With Marco, early on, like with most young players, they didn't entrust him with a lot of high leverage minutes or a lot of minutes in general, and wanted him to earn his ice time. And Marco accepted that challenge, at times challenged it, but accepted the challenge of being played less, to understand that he would have to play the right way in order to generate more minutes. And as the year went on, that's exactly what happened. When in the playoffs, he was really good. A lot of late viewings, recency bias. You have the men's worlds where he played with Austria, and I think I'd have to double check this, but if he wasn't the top ice time guy for Austria, including defenseman, he was in the top 3. And that says a lot when it's your forward playing the most minutes for you. So I think that steady progression and climb upward tells me that from a playing perspective, he's entered the fray as a top 10 guy. Now, I know for me personally, and I put a lot of stock into the interviews that we do at the Combine, this guy shows up in a suit. He's polished. He's genuine. He's engaging. He's not just, oh, yeah, here, yeah, good to see you, good to see you. Shakes your hand, looks you in the eye, and right away you feel connection with him. And then you hear his story, how he left at 16. You know, his parents drive from Austria to Sweden. They stay with 2 weeks. Here's how to use a stove. Here's how to use the washing machine. Here's how to cook your own food. Okay, see you later, buddy. Guy goes, learns 3 languages. He's on his own from 16 years old. He's sitting in a high school classroom. It'd be like, you know, turn back the clock 50 years, 3 Mendes, to when you were in high school, and be like you sitting beside, you know, Guy Lafleur in the classroom type of thing. That you have like this SHL player in your high school classroom. So all these little bits and pieces come together for me. You look at the player, you look at the character, and all of a sudden you've got a top 10 pick.
Someone who will go through a wall to win. Lots of teams were high on Marco Kasper. The Detroit Red Wings were the ones that got him, and he brings an element that few, if any, other players in this draft can bring. This is another hit pick from the Red Wings. There's a lot of disappointed general managers on this floor right now that didn't get Marco Kasper.
This kid is going to be hard to play against in hard areas, and he's going to score some goals, but be responsible everywhere else on the ice.
He's got more of a North American presence than a lot of kids that are coming out of that league right now, and a lot of that's because how physical he is.
Yes, a Steve Yzerman player made in a lab, basically. Like, it is a speedy, competitive, efficient center.
But also just having a guy who, you know, kind of a fear no one mentality. Like, he's pretty physical.
Can you explain your game a little bit for us?
Yeah, I'm really want to win, really competitive player.
Highly competitive. Probably the most competitive player in the draft in terms of, like, you know, who's willing to run through how many walls on the ice.
He builds the walls before each game to run through.
Yeah.
Extremely strong forechecker, competes ridiculously hard, high motor, hits everything, ball of hate.
Those are the adjectives.
Those are the adjectives.
We'll be right back.
a unique counter.
From the heavens, through hostile fire they will march, unaffected by the volleys. This is death for fate, will keep the fear at bay. Into battle, facing the fire, Lord, I will be done. Into battle, walking alive, see the white in their eyes.
He drives the net, he can play the perimeter, he can play off the cycle, he's hard on pucks, he battles.
Yeah.
Yeah, in terms of what you notice from his game, that well-roundedness, and then as a byproduct of that, NHL readiness. Like, he is playing the kind of game where it should translate, again, not to say he's an automatic shoe-in to make the roster, but it kind of gives him a leg up in terms of he plays the kind of game that gets you onto a roster sooner. Fair?
I think that's a really good way to put it. Like, I, you know, just like I said with Edmonton, I think I know I need to be a little more reserved in how readily I proclaim stuff like that. But the stylistic elements, right? Like, you talk about what does it take to adjust to North America? You got to be ready to play with the speed. You got to be ready for the increased physicality. Those might be the two best things in Marco Kasper's game. He's a great skater. He plays with a ton of pace, and he is not afraid to mix it up. He's not afraid to throw a hit. He's not afraid to take a hit around the net. Like, we're talking about probably the two strengths of his game, and his compete and his pace for me. It would not surprise me. Like, the question, as with all Red Wings prospects, is what kind of role are they going to have, right? The Red Wings aren't going to want to keep someone in Detroit to play a fourth line role when they could have a top line role in Grand Rapids. But if he could play a top nine role, which in this case probably means a third line role, you know, I don't think that's out of the question.
Valinder. Kommer skott från Larsson. Riks här I studs. Kasper vill ha pucken. Kasper får den.
He's an aggressive forecheck. He is chasing down opponents. He is hounding down these guys. And the reason he's able to play at a pro level so soon, Ross, is because of he's got a good frame. 6'1", 183 pounds. And he uses his size to protect the puck when he's carrying it. And he's so physical that he makes his opponents react quick and make hasty decisions. Like, they see him on the ice, they see him coming at them with speed, and they're like, I got to get rid of this before I get crushed. And what happens is, when you constantly have guys thinking like that, they're not going to be making smart, good decisions, and you're going to be turning that puck over, or you're going to be allowing your teammates to turn that puck over more often than not. And I think that's Marco Kasper's biggest attribute, is his ability to put teams on their heels, keep them on their toes, and keep them off.
Marco Kasper. Linden är mot Larsson, Kasper. Den som ofta hittar en smart väg till pucken, står Lyrenäs. Här är Valinder! Kasper. Yes.
I anfallszonen. Marco Kasper tar pucken.
Tom Nilsson istället, Hazard får inte iväg den. Jo, nästa läge så är det Kasper, Marco Kasper. Och så in mot det farliga området. Det är kamp om pucken, domaren blåser för att det ligger spelare I nätet.
He's just gonna be such a pain in the ass to play against.
Yeah, his strengths include puck carrying and puck possession. He's a play driver with high stick on puck possession time, and he's a strong decision maker. Reads plays well, makes smart decisions offensively and defensively.
What intrigues you most about him, Jason?
Well, 200-foot game. He's another guy that can play the wing and center ice. And what he did is only grow exponentially as the season got harder.
He does everything pretty right. Like, there's not a huge glaring weakness.
Marco Kasper has the most complete game of maybe anybody in this draft. He's a full 200-foot player, and he has no weaknesses as a player.
Han har så många delar I sitt spel. Ante och Suomela. Alltså hans passningsblick. Han växlar tempo. Här kan det bli något för Rögle. Och det trafik framför och pucken låter in! Hur han har tillbaka Tim Juhl. Han tillbaka när pucken studsar. Vilket lag vinner den? Det gör Frölunda och Pontus Johansson. Där är det Edström. Där är det Marco Kasper. Kasper är det. Marco Kasper vinner tillbaka den. Blixtrar han är snabbt.
Amo sexlarvar. Kladdar med pucken. Bra vakten offside. Leksand som tvingas ur. Kasper tar fart, kommer igenom mittzon och utmanar, men ett samlat Leksands försvar kan ganska enkelt.
Marcos som stöter ut pucken. for Kasper.
Bertilsson, långspel här ute för Timmarsson som håller i. Timmarsson spelar där borta. Men inte alls långt borta att den pucken fastnar.
I look at Kasper and I look at a guy who's already doing the things that you need to do to play the hardest position in terms of, you know, converting this to NHL talent. It's hard to get drafted as a center and stay as a center. Seems like he's doing everything right. He's doing it in both zones. He works his absolute ass off. He's getting better. Everyone, I'm looking at the notes here from, I think it's Scott Wheeler's rankings, and he talked about what Cam Abbott said about Kasper, and obviously like managers and coaches are going to talk about their own players through the roof, but it's really promising stuff.
He's a 17-year-old playing in one of the best leagues in the world on a very good team. He has very little room for error in order to maintain a roster spot, so he probably is playing a little more conservatively because, well, he can't make mistakes or he ain't playing. So once he gets a little older, a little better, a little more skill, he can open up and really, you know, flex his talent.
Kasper. Jonsson. Står Lydenäs.
Spelar där. Värmblom. Tappar kontrollen av pucken och Ludvig Larsson kan ta den. Studsande puck från Marmelin som låter den gå förbi sig utan att röra pucken. Kasper står Lyrenäs framför burspelar istället för Engström! Och Adam Engström reducerar för Rögle. Det är 2-1 i Malmö Arena.
Istället vänder spelet Forsberg. Marco Kasper som är väl med i backcheckingen och vinner tillbaka pucken för Rögles del. Full fart framåt för österrikaren. Lämnar över och ska stå Lyrenäs.
Petersson har med sig Shore. Sund, det är sällan man ser Sund så här långt framme. Men det är ett bra driv på kassen som öppnar upp. Står Lyrenäs, passning är farlig. Jon Knuts med lite fart. Kasper för att hämta pucken.
Droppar, Råhomma droppar. Skott från vinkel och går klubban av.
Norens klubba går av.
Leksand behåller och där kommer nästa skott. Och då är det Marco Kasper som kan stämma att Roma kunde gått på direktskott. Det kommer... Och titta som han kämpar!
Kastar ut den här i alla fall. Det är nära till Edström. Och... Sjöholm, skottläge för Viktor Sjöholm. Väldigt fint utav Ludvig Larsson. Som sträcker fram klubban i rätt läge. Kommer han i ett friläge också. Ludvig Larsson! Johnny!
Fokusera lite på Rögle ser vi samtidigt som Valinde gör det där målet. Tycker jag att...
Lukas Elvenäs. För Lang. Ja, Kasper. Som hanterar det på bästa sätt. Går på kropp där han om pucken tar sig ur situationen. Kan vända spel då.
So, in his draft year, I think I was on him pretty early. I really liked him, especially, you know, just the profile that I think fit for Detroit. And a lot of the things I saw, the compete, the physicality for a young player, but the skating, the intelligence, the responsibility, right? Like, that's all there. I don't know that I really gave enough credit to his offensive game. And I think, you know, I think that that's probably a pretty universal thing.
We think he has underrated skill, and we think he has the ability to play in our top six. One day, I can't tell you if it's next year or the year after, but we have high hopes for him and very excited to pick him.
Don't.
much as like I was someone who I did feel like he was a reasonable value pick, the pick that I would have made in that spot, I still have and had questions about like what is the ultimate offensive ceiling. And I think part of that has already been kind of, you're already kind of seeing, hey, this is a guy who has good hands. This is a guy who can make plays. I heard Danielle Bruce on the last episode talking about the vision and the playmaking. Like those are all things that if you continue to see them, you're going to all of a sudden be really, really excited about what this could be. Question is, how much is he going to score? I think you can still ask the question, right? But the guy has the puck a lot. Like, you watch his game and, you know, can that even occasionally get him into a little bit of trouble? Maybe. But like, the guy has the puck a lot. He transports the puck. He retrieves the puck. He shoots the puck. He goes in, you know, he can make a play with his feet. He can make a play with a pass. Like, there's a lot of nice elements to his game. It's not like we're talking about, you know, Connor McDavid hands necessarily here, or Nathan MacKinnon or whatever. So don't get that idea in your head, but like, there's a lot of really good elements to this player. I think one of the names I would throw around in his draft, or a couple of them, I think Anthony Cirelli, and I think it might've been Corey who used Sam Bennett, but I think there's even more offense than that. And so I might've probably undersold that part of his game at that time. You know, where exactly is he going to fall? I don't know. But like, one of the names I think I remember using was Nazem Kadri. I think that might even be a more apt comp at this point after seeing him. And I mean, Kadri's coming off an unreal year. I'm not necessarily saying it's that, you know, with whatever he had, 90 points with the Avalanche. But in terms, I really think there's like a 50s to 60s point center here. And maybe it's more, right? Like, I don't know that I saw Matty Beniers being a point per game center right away either. But, you know, I think there's certainly a very well-rounded player here, and I don't just mean that to mean defense. Like, there's a lot of elements.
Vad får han med sig? Kasper bland andra. Titta på Kasper som lägger upp det på bladet, och här händer det grejer. Han är ett sånt där lacrossmål. Står Lyrenäs. Och vilken sekvens. Det är 2-4. Här händer det mer än vad det kan göra under en hel ishockeymatch. Och Oskar Ståhl Lyrenäs, som är glödhet. Han gör sitt fjärde mål för säsongen.
Well, now is the time to get a taste of the future for Red Wings first-round pick Marco Kasper. Check him out in his gear. The Red Wings calling up the 8th overall pick from last year's draft. He skated with the team in Winnipeg this morning, but he's not expected to make his NHL debut tonight against the Jets. When he does, he'll be wearing number 92 with the Wings.
It's still kind of been a little bit of a whirlwind. Like, oh my God, a few days ago, I wasn't even, you know, now you're in the NHL playing already.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I was just back in Sweden, coming here, and then just going on a road trip with the Detroit Red Wings. By the way, it's kind of surreal, but it's so fun.
To me, he does all those little perimeter things that are important to go along with the skill he already has. He's a tough customer. He's going to get in the stuff in front of the net. He drives the net. He does all the little things right already. He's only 18.
Look at that. And random, all the future of the race.
crazy to see that Steve Yzerman, I'll have to talk to him about this, but he's drafted Hart and Compete. He did it with Sider, and he's doing it with this kid right here.